Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As it has been advertised, in these fortnight reminders, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to be looking at a surah from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that serves as a model and a template for any successful society, community, or organization. So if you want to build a successful Muslim community, society, organization, this surah is the perfect model on how to build a community, how to build our families. Because there is no system, management system, procedure that's better than the system or the management of the one that created the heavens and the earth. No matter how big your organization is, how complex your societies and communities are, it could never be as complex, as large, massive, complicated, like the creation of the heavens and the earth. And if you look at the heaven and the earth and everything contained within it, it runs so smoothly in synergy, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, La shamsu yambaghi laha an tudrika al-qamar wa la laylu sabiqun nahar. It could never happen that the sun overtakes the moon. It never happens. Or for the night to precede the day, because the system Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed. How does it work? Kullun fi falakin yasbahun. Everything goes in a smooth transitional orbit. So if you want to be the best manager, the best project manager, if you want to come up with the best SOP, standard operating procedure, there's nothing better to you have for you to have as a foundation than what? Qur'an wa Sunnah. And for those who come to the fiqh class, for example, if you look at acts of worship, the salah that we just prayed now, or even the wudu, how these things, for those who bother to learn it, is described in such intricate details. It's as though if you follow these details or description how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed, is as though you could see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in front of you. So this surah, it contains the instructions and the guidelines how to build a proper community. Because this surah, if you want to build a community, what do you need to start with in a community or country? You need a dastur. You need a constitution. This surah begins with the first constitution, what we refer all affairs back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to who? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Contained in this surah is our etiquette, our mannerism when it comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Contained in this surah is how we should deal with news, information that has reached us from sources. So in this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِن جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَئٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا. If a fasiq brings news to you, what should you do? Verify the information. So if a fasiq comes to me, do you reject his news or accept his news? What do we do? Do you reject or accept? We verify. What if he's not a fasiq? He comes to us. If he's not an evil liver, a sinner, a righteous person comes to us. Do we accept his news? Yes, we accept his news. What if his news is accusing somebody else of something? For example, a righteous person comes to us. And what is apparent? And he accuses somebody of zina. What do we do? Do we accept his news or reject his news? Or do we verify? Yeah, Luqman, what do we do? We don't verify. If he comes with news accusing somebody of zina, we do not accept, we do not reject, we do not verify. In lam yatu bi arba'ati shuhada, if he does not bring four witnesses, no matter how pious he is, if he accuses a person of it, thamanuna jalda, is whipped 80 times. Ala tul. So in this surah, it solves this issue. This surah tells us how to deal with disputes amongst the believers. وَإِنْ طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا. If two groups of the believers are fight, فَأَصْلِحُ بَيْنَهُمَا. Do sulh, reconcile between them. If one of them transgresses against the other, فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَبْغِي حَتَّى تَفِيَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. Fight the one that's transgressing until it comes back to the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This surah, it teaches us how we should deal with each other as a community. Because as a community, which is mentioned in the surah, Ya ayyuha an-nas, O mankind, we've made you what? Nations and tribe. As we sit here right now, we're all different nations, different nationality, different complexions. How do we deal with each other? And what shouldn't we do that would destroy our community? Racism, prejudice, nationalism, which the root of it and the practices of it is based in what? In mockery. So this surah contained in it is what? La yaskhur qawm min qawm. A set of people should never mock another set of people. No matter what their nationality may be, their complexion may be, the languages they speak is contained in this surah. This surah also mentions things that destroys communities, such as suspicion, backbiting, and slander. So the surah we're looking at, inshallah ta'ala, if we practice it, bi-idhnillah ta'ala, in this series of reminders, we have the best of communities, inshallah ta'ala. This surah is called Sura Al-Hujurat. The Surah of Al-Hujurat. Al-Hujurat is the plural of Hujurah, the plural of chamber. So the Surah of the Chambers. And what is meant here by the chambers is the houses of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So each one of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had her own what? House. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ya ayyuhalladhina aman la tadkhulu buyutan nabi. All you believe, do not enter onto the houses of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So therefore, for those brothers, inshallah ta'ala, who are brave enough and mashallah ta'ala, the sunnah enough, that are looking to practice polygamy, each wife is her right to have her own house. You cannot force another wife, say, you know what, sister, taqillah, she have zuhud, live in the other house with the other sister. La. Each one should have her own house. So the surah is Surah Al-Hujurat, the surah of the compartments. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it begins the surah with, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, la tuqaddimu bayna yadayhi Allah wa rasulihi, wattaqullah, inna Allah sami'un alim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, oh you believe, do not put yourself forth or precede in anything before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala began the surah with ya. Ya in Arabic, harful nida. It's a letter that's used for calling or making an announcement. And what is the purpose of ya? لتنبيه المخاطب, to draw or alert the person you're speaking to. So in the very beginning of this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is alerting us and drawing our attention to something by simply saying what? Ya. And then Allah ta'ala said, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, all you who believe. So the attention or those who is alerting who? Those who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this shows the importance of what is going to come. Because Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, he mentions, إِذَا سَمِعْتَ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى يَقُولِ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فَأَرْعِيهَا سَمَعَكَ. Whenever you hear in the Quran or you read or you believe, lend your ears to it. إِمَّا خَيْرٌ تُؤْمَرُ بِهِ. It's either goodness you've been ordered with or شَرٌ تُنْهَا عَنْ, or evil you've been prohibited from. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling us to something or prohibiting us from something. And Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions that whenever you hear this, that this is an evidence أن الالتزام بما خطب به من مقتضيات الإيمان. That whenever you hear يا أيها الذين آمنوا, for you to practice what is being said is from the signs of what? Or the conditions of what? Iman. For you to go against it is from the signs of what? Deficiency in your Iman, your faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressing us with in this ayah? Allah ta'ala says, do not precede Allah and his messenger, or put yourself forth before them until you know the statement of Allah, the ruling of Allah, the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the ruling of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam concerning that particular affair. And from the worst forms of a person putting himself forth before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is what? Bid'ah, innovation. Because a person that invents in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it innovates with his actions, because action speaks, and sometimes action speaks louder than word. With his actions, he's though he's saying, أَنَّ الشَّرِيعَ لَمْ تُكْمَلْ. The sharia of Allah is not being perfected. And the bid'ah, which is come with the innovation, his intentions are good. And he wants to do what with it? Complete the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you was to ask him, this bid'ah, this innovation which you're doing, by doing it, you're doing one or two things. You're either completing the sharia, perfecting it, or it's a deficiency. If he says he's doing it to perfect the sharia, this is what? Denial of the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-yawm akmaltu lakum deenakum. Today I've completed and perfected your religion for you. And if he's saying he's not doing that, then what is it? Deficiency in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So from the worst types of a person putting himself before Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is innovation in the deen. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, kullu bid'atin dalala. Every single bid'ah, there's no bid'ah hasana. Dalala. Wa kullu dalala fi nar. Every single dalala going astray is in the hellfire. So this ayah, it tells us not to put ourselves before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his message sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until we know the rulings. And it also displays to us, or demonstrates to us, the importance of following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because many ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will mention destructive issues, and then followed by is what? The remedy. The remedy, alaykum bi sunnati, upon you is my sunnah. Wa sunnah al-khulafa al-rashideen. And the sunnah of the khulafa al-rashideen al-mahdiyeen. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do not put yourself forth before Allah and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to say, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ and fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does it mean, اتَّقُوا اللَّهِ? When somebody says to you, اتَّقِ اللَّهِ, many a times it's translated as what? Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But is taqwa, is it really fear? What's the proper translation of a taqwa? Ya Aba Amitullah. Barakallahu feek. Yes. Linguistically, it comes from the verb ittaqa shay. For example, you're walking into an area which is full of thorns, and you're walking and you're treading carefully. Ittaqaita. You've treaded carefully, fearing to step on the thorns. So a taqwa, therefore, according to the definition of the scholar La Talq ibn Habib, is a taqwa an ta'mal bi ta'atillah ala nuri min Allah, tarju thawab min Allah. Piety is for you to act in obedience of Allah, hoping for a reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hoping for a reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Upon a light from Allah, hoping for a reward from Allah azza wa jal. Wa an tatruk ma'siyat Allah. True taqwa, you leave off the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fearing the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Upon a light from Allah azza wa jal. So this is taqwa. It's not just fear, it's to do these actions. And that's why Uthaymeen rahimahullah azza wa jal, in his definition of taqwa, it's a ittikhad al-waqaya. Is to seek a barrier or a shield from the punishment of Allah. How do you do this? How do you do this? بِفِعْلِ أَوَامِرِهِ by carrying out the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala وَتَرْكْ نَوَاهِهِ and leaving off the prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, taqwa is to have a barrier or shield between you and the punishment of Allah by doing what is obligated upon you and leaving what is prohibited. This is taqwa. And to practice this taqwa, you have to use the definition, understand the definition of who? Ali radiallahu anhu. And what is this definition of taqwa? It's a taqwa al-amalu bi-tanzeel. Taqwa is that you have to act according to what has been revealed. Meaning act according to what? Quran and sunnah. Because the sunnah is a revelation. So taqwa al-amalu bi-tanzeel, according to Ali radiallahu anhu, is to act according to what has been revealed. وَالْخَوْفُ مِنَ الْجَلِيلِ and to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have fear. So the first thing is acting according to what? Revelation. Secondly, fear. Because you cannot fear if you don't know the one you're fearing. And that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ the people that have the true fear, based on knowledge of who? The people of knowledge. And thirdly, القناعه بقليل to be pleased with little والاستعداد ليوم الرحيل. Why should you be pleased with little? Because of the fourth thing, to prepare for the day you're going to depart from this dunya. This is a taqwa. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. Orders the believers. We're living in a time now when you tell people اتَّقِ اللَّهِ when he does something. Akhi, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People say, who are you to tell me to fear Allah? I fear Allah. Allah Ta'ala is ordering the believers. In fact, Allah Ta'ala ordered the best of people, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Ya ayyuhan nabi ittaqillah. O Messenger of Allah, fear Allah. So Allah Ta'ala is ordered, wattaqullah, and fear Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. And how does the ayah end? Ya Shaykhuna, kayfa ayah? How does the ayah end? Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala ends the ayah how? Verily, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, sami'un alim. Sami'un alim. And this shows, subhanAllah, the importance of following the sunnah and not innovating even in issues of aqidah, issues of belief. Allah Ta'ala ends the ayah by saying, Allah is sami'un. He hears all things, is the all-hearing, the all-knowing. And now does this tie in with our aqidah? They said, based on the fact that Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala ends the verse with these two attributes, the ulama derive from this, the hadhihi jumla jumla tahziriyah, that these two names ending like this, this sentence is a sentence of warning. How is this sentence a sentence of warning? That Allah Ta'ala said, is sami'un alim. How is it a warning? They say it is a warning because Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, when he says sami'un alim, is all hearing, is all seeing. For you, an la taqa'a fima naha Allahu an, for you not to fall into what Allah Ta'ala has prohibited, from putting yourself between before Allah and His Messenger. If you truly believe, Allah sees and knows everything you do. This is jumla tahziriya, for you not to, or to go against that which Allah has ordered with. And what's Allah ordered in the first ayah? Taqwa. If you truly believe, Allah is what? Sami'un alimun. He hears and knows everything. So when people study classes of aqidah, of creed, people think it's just mental gymnastic theory. No. It has a bearing on your actions. It has a bearing on your what? Actions. But you have to first and foremost accept those things as attributes according to what? The sunnah. Meaning you don't do tamthil. You do not compare Allah's attributes to the attributes of the creation. Laysa kamithlihi shay. There's nothing like Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. Wa huwa sami'ul alim. Is all hearing, all knowing. Secondly, you do not deny the attributes of Allah. You don't do ta'til. That no, we can't say Allah hears. We hear, He hears. Yeah, we've made insan sami'an basira. Mankind, he hears, he sees. Allah hears, he sees. No, Allah is not, he doesn't hear things. Basically, Allah is a sami', his name is sami', but he doesn't hear. Does that make sense? He's the all hearing, but he doesn't hear. But when you have the proper creed, this will serve as a what? Tahdhiriyah. When you understand what it means that Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala is all hearing and all seeing. So what does it mean, Allah is all hearing? They say the hearing of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala is divided into two categories. Sam'u al-idraq wa sam'u al-istijaba. The hearing, the first category, al-idraq, which comprehends and encompasses every single thing. And the second category is what? Istijab, the hearing of answering a call. So when Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala says, oh hearing, istijab, we answer your calls, meaning answer your what? Ad-du'a. So the first category is what? Al-idraq. Allah comprehends and his hearing encompasses every single sound. And this first category of idraq, they say anytime you read it in the Quran, and take a lesson from this, anytime you have sami', it's intended, or the purpose of it are three. What's the first purpose? We've just mentioned it. The first purpose, when you hear Allah is sami', is what? It's a what? Warning, like this ayah. And an example of that is the saying of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, لَقَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ فَقِيرٌ وَنَحْنُ أَغْنِيَاءُ. Allah Ta'ala said, indeed, Allah has heard the statement or the sayings of those who say Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala is poor and we're rich. So what kind, when Allah Ta'ala said He has heard here, what does it serve as? A warning. Allah Ta'ala says, سَنَكْتُبُ مَا قَالُوا وَقَتْلُهُمَ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. We should write down what they said and the killing of the prophets. But the interesting thing in this verse is, Allah Ta'ala said, we're going to write down what they did to the prophets or what they said. What they said concerning who? Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. That naqsu, or naqsu Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, for a person to describe Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, wasfu Allah Ta'ala bin naqs, to describe Allah with deficiency, is worse than what? The killing of the prophets. Allah Ta'ala said, سَنَكْتُبُ مَا فَعَلُوا. He didn't say we're going to write down what they did to the prophet. سَنَكْتُبُ مَا قَالُوا. We're going to write down what they did. May they be called to account for it. And this is why when we say aqidah, it's very important. So the first category, when you hear sami' in the Quran, is for what? Warning. The second thing is to what? Know that Allah's hearing encompasses what? Every single thing. The saying of Allah Ta'ala in Surah Al-Mujadala, قَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّتِي تُجَادِلُكَ فِي zawjiha wa tashtaki ila Allah. That Allah has heard the complaint of the one arguing with you concerning a husband. To show how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's hearing encompasses every single voice, when this ayah was revealed, Aisha radiallahu anha, you know what she said? She said, Alhamdulillah alladhi wasi'a sam'ahu al-aswat kullaha. Indeed, all praise is due to Allah, whose hearing encompasses everything. Why did she say this? When this lady came to complain to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam concerning her husband, Aisha radiallahu anha, she was in the next room. She says, Sami'tu ba'd hadith. I could hear some of the things she was saying, but I couldn't hear some of it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from above the seven heavens, heard every single thing she said. So the second Sami' in the Quran is what? Allah's hearing encompasses everything. And the last category is, we've done the three categories. Either a warning encompasses everything, and what else? A call. That Allah Ta'ala answers your call. Inna Rabbi Sami'u Dua. That my Lord, He has my dua. And this is the statement of who? Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. And the second category, as I said, is what? Al istijaba. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sorry, afwan. Istijaba is the second category. The types, you got that wrong. The types are three. Warning encompasses everything. And what's the last type? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will aid you. So anytime you hear Sami' in the Quran, it could also mean what? The victory of Allah will come to you. And what's the example of this? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Musa and Harun, Inni ma'akuma, la takhafa, have no fear. Why? Inni ma'akuma, I'm with you. How am I with you? Asma'u wa ara, I hear everything and I see everything. I'll aid you. So therefore, when you hear Sami' in the Quran, either as a warning, Allah will aid you or answer your what? Aid you, barakallahu feek. And the second category is what? Istijaba. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will answer all your dua. Then Allah ta'ala says, Alimun. This is even stronger than Sami'un. Because Sami' it means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has jami' al-masmu'at, every single thing which is uttered, which is heard. But Alimun is more general. He has everything which is uttered and that which is not uttered. Meaning, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that وَنَعْلَمُ مَا تُوَسْوِسُ بِهِ نَفْسُ. Even that which your soul is whispering to you, Allah Ta'ala knows. So when a person has this aqidah, Allah knows everything which I do, sees everything and hears everything which I do, and he really believes this, do you think he will say something from innovation or disobedience or filth that Allah Ta'ala is not pleased with or do it? If he really believes this, la. And that's why they say this jumla in this ayah, is it for what? Is it for aiding, answering the dua? Is for what? Warning in this ayah. That if you know Allah hears and sees everything, do not ever put yourself before Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wattaqullah, and fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah ta'ala, sami'un alim. In the next ayah, and we'll end with this inshallah ta'ala. Allah ta'ala said, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. Again, all you believe, la tarfa'u aswatakum fawqa sawti an-nabi. Oh, you believe, do not raise your voice above the voice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Kajahri ba'dukum, the same way you raise your voice to one another. An tahbata a'malukum wa antum la tash'urun, that you cause your actions to become null and void. And the dangerous thing about this is what? Wa antum la tash'urun, you don't even know that you were doing that in the first place. So in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do not raise your voices above the voice of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They say in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what this means is that a person, he shouldn't speak at the same volume as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if the Prophet raises his voice, you raise your voice too, but he should never reach the level of the voice of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The same way we speak to each other. You can raise your voice with me, I raise my voice with you. We speak at the same volume. But when it comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you should not do it. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. No matter how good an opinion you have, no matter how strong what you want to say is, it should never be above the voice of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the sabab al-nuzul, the reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this ayah to show the danger of this issue is, Allah ta'ala revealed this ayah concerning the best generation of Sahaba. And concerning two of the best of the Sahaba. And what are the two of the best of the Sahaba? Al-Khayran, Abu Bakr and Umar. They said, Kada الخيران يهلكان. The two, the best of this ummah, they almost became destroyed. Why? A group came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from Banu Tamim. And when they came, and they wanted to know where the emir should be, Abu Bakr said, أمر عليهم أقرع ابن حابس. Make أقرع ابن حابس the emir, the leader. And Umar said, no, make it somebody else. Abu Bakr said, you only said what you said to contradict me. And the voice went and he raised above the voice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And to us, it's a simple affair. But yet Allah Ta'ala says, your actions may become null and void just due to the actions. وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. That after this, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, whenever they address the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they address him by whispering. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will have to answer, what did you say? Repeat that again, just because it is ayah. Another Sahabi, Thabit ibn Qais, was known as min al-khutaba, from the people that Prophet ﷺ would make give speeches, because he had jawhariya to salt, a loud voice. When this ayah was revealed, he went missing. The Sahaba, because he had a loud voice, they were looking for him. And the Prophet ﷺ, iftaqadahu, he missed him and he noticed he's not there, because he used to know what companions there, what is not there, from the care and the concerns of the Prophet ﷺ. So he asked the Sahaba, where is he? They said he's not coming. So one Sahabi went to see him, Thabit ibn Qais. Thabit ibn Qais, from the time this ayah was revealed, he sat in his house crying. And when the Sahabi went to see him, he said, I sit in my house crying because all my actions become null and void. I'm from the people of the hellfire because of his loud voice. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, tell him, he's min ahli jannah, from the people of Jannah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, Ya Thabit, ala tarda. O Thabit, are you not pleased? An ta'ish hamidan wa tuqtalu shaheedan wa tadkhulu al-jannah. Would you not be pleased to live an honorable life, die as a shaheed, and enter Jannah? He said, Bala. He said, you're from the people of Jannah. You're going to live an honorable life. You're going to die as a shaheed, and you're going to enter Jannah. And Thabit ibn Qais, how did he die? In the battle of Yamama, shaheedan. And min ahli Jannah, by the testimony of who? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. La tarfa'u. Do not raise your voice above the voice of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is like the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, La taj'alu du'a al-rasul ka du'a'i ba'dikum ba'da. Do not make the calling of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam like the calling of one of you. Meaning, if one of you calls the other, you could comply or disobey. But when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam calls you, what should you do? Istajibu lillah wa lil-rasul. Answer the call of Allah and His Messenger. I mean, if He calls you, you must comply. They say, don't make the call of the Prophet ﷺ like the call of one of you. Also means, I call him Abu Abdullah, I call him Luqman, I call him Sheikh Shahid, I call him Abu Mu'adh. As for the Prophet ﷺ, which you hear, of course, we expect this from non-Muslim, that Muhammad was a great man. And some Muslims you hear as well, Muhammad did this, Muhammad did that. Which Muhammad? Your neighbor, your driver, your manager at work? Which Muhammad are you talking about? Who is Muhammad? Rasulullah. You never find a hadith where the Sahaba will say Muhammad. So don't call the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the way you call each other, Muhammad. La, the Messenger of Allah, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also, not raising your voice above the voice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not to have al-istihana bi-sunnah, to belittle, disrespect the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after the death of the Prophet ﷺ. Because what will happen? What's the result of it? Your action become what? Null and void. How does a person's action become null and void? From disrespecting, belittling, or mocking the sunnah. How? Because mocking the sunnah, belittling the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, it could actually lead to what? Apostasy. I know your actions become null and void. And this is the danger of mocking the sunnah. It's very, very, very dangerous affair. If you don't follow the sunnah, you find it difficult, do not mock the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Or belittle the sunnah. Like many a times you tell people, do this, do that. Say, akhi, man, it's only sunnah. What does it mean, it's only sunnah? It's only the words of the Prophet sallallahu. It's only sunnah. Or mocking the sunnah. The munafiqeen in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they said, ma ra'ina mithla. We've not seen the likes of these reciters of ours, meaning the ulama of the Sahaba and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they were joking. They said, we've not seen the likes of these people. They have the biggest stomachs. They love to eat. وَأَجْنَبُ عِنْدَ الْلِقَاءِ When it comes to fighting these people, they're the most cowardly. They're the most cowardly. وَأَكْذِبُ الْسُنَنِ And the most, when it comes to lie, they have the most lying tongues. And when they said the statement they were saying, why did they say it? كُنَّ نَخُوضُ وَنَلْعَبُ We're only playing around and just joking. Like people mock the sunnah like this. Look at this brother's beard. They see a brother, maybe his thobe or his trousers above the ankle, say, look at him, mashallah. Land cruiser, 4x4, coming in our way. These mockeries, these jokes that you think you're joking with and you're mocking the sunnah, they say, كُنَّا نَخُوضُ وَلَعَبُ We're just passing time and joking. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says? أَبِاللَّهِ Is it Allah? وَآيَاتِهِ And the verses or the signs of Allah, وَرَسُولِهِ And his messenger, كُنْتُمْ تَسْتَهْزِئُونَ You're mocking? لَا تَعْتَذِرُوا For this, there's no more excuse. قَدْ كَفَرْتُمْ بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ You've become kuffar after your believers. So لا ترفعوا Don't ever raise your voice above the voice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Somebody say قال رسول الله خلاص انتهى الأمر أمر رسول الله the Prophet ordered this نهى خلاص انتهى الأمر So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said أن تحبط أعمالكم وأنتم لا تشعرون That your actions by doing so become null and void. And there's many other things that makes a person's action null and void. Shirk billah, associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Missing salatul asr in jama'ah, it makes the actions of all that day become null and void. It's like you lost your whole family or your whole wealth. And tahbata a'malukum wa antum la tash'urun. That your action become null and void and you do not realize. Next week, inshallah ta'ala, we'll go on to the next ayah number 3, inshallah ta'ala. Jazakumullah khairan.